developers. The examples in this tutorial will be illustrated through the Chamilo project. Chamilo is an e-learning management system. So basically it's an open source system, a free software application, which means that a lot of people contribute to it. We have around 40 people contributing to the development of Chamilo. So when we speak about, when we talk about 40 people working together from different places around the world, it's really important to have a specific tool that will allow us to coordinate all these development efforts and to avoid duplication in the work and that kind of stuff. So Redmine is an issue management system, so it allows you to manage all kind of things that occur around and inside a software development project. What we're gonna see then, if I have a look at the table of contents, we're gonna see how to create an account, how the general interface looks like, how to report an issue, how to change the status of an issue, how to track time, and then we're gonna see a few additional points. So Redmine, when you connect to it, it pretty much looks like this. It's a basic interface. You have a home section, which is the introduction to this installation of Redmine. Generally, you explain how to become a developer, for example, or how to report a bug and that kind of stuff in this section. Then you have the latest news, which is the list of news that have been published in every one of these projects. So you can see every time you have the name of the project, it's a link, so you can click on the link and get to the homepage of the project. You have the link to the announcement itself, and then the link to the person who posted it. And then you have a small box, which isn't really useful in our case, of the latest projects inside the Chamilo LMS development project. So the idea of all these projects is that if you have one big software project, you might have like a project for documentation, a project for the design and that kind of stuff, which allow basically people to work together in a separate space. So the first step to start working on Chamilo would be to register an account. So for that, you have to click on the register link on the top right link, and you will have like a small section asking you for a login, which is your username usually, for a password, to repeat the password, and then your first name, your last name, and your email. Your email is very important because that's where you're gonna receive all the changes inside the application or inside the issues. The language is your language. It's gonna change the interface basically. You can put the country if you like or the birthdate, but that's specific to this Chamilo installation. So I already have an account. So if you register an account on the Chamilo website, that's support.chamilo.org, we will take a few hours to check the validity of your account and then authorize the creation of your account. So you should just register this form and then come back a few hours later and try to log in with your login and password. So if you have already created your account, you get to the sign in page, which is also the link on the top right side. You just give your login, your password. In my case, it's my computer, so I'm quite sure that nobody else is gonna use it. So I click on stay logged in, so that my session remains open as much as possible. Then I log in, and when you log in, you'll get to your page. That's your my page. And your page will tell you which issues are assigned to you, which issues you watch, and what is the time spent. That's coming from a plugin that we have installed on the system. So maybe you don't have it Redmine, but you can add this plugin and it's a very, very useful plugin. Okay, so in terms of interface, you can see that we have a first link here that says home, which is the first page that we saw before. My page is the page that we just saw right now. Projects is the list of projects available to you, so the public projects or the projects to which you are subscribed. And you can enter any project to see the details of this project. The time tracker is something available only when you install the time tracker tool. The administration link is only available when you are administrator of the Redmine platform. And help is a series of a link to a series of documents that can help you on the Redmine website. On the other side, you can see that you are logged in as Y1. That's my account, but you will see your username there. You can click on it and then see details about that user, your specific sheet. That's the view that other users will have if they look at your account, if they follow a link of some place where you reported an issue or something like that. Then you can see a time counter which is not running right now. That's normal, that comes from the time tracker plugin. You have the My Account tab, which is basically your account, your country, your date of birth, and then what type of frequency you want for the email notification. So you can define if you want to receive an event in every project that you're working on, or if you don't want to be notified, or anyway, then you choose. And then you have the time zone, which is important if you have a geographically spread population of developers, because then they will see stuff in their time frame, and you will see in their time zone, and you will see stuff in your time zone, and that's much better for everybody. You can also have you have a lot of stuff that you can do additionally to connect this account to something external, but that's not part of this tutorial. And then you have the sign out link, which allows you to disconnect from your account. And then you have a search box. Yeah, the search box allows you to decide in which project you're gonna search. So let's say I want to search in the Jamilo project. I haven't entered any search term inside the search box, so it will basically send me to the homepage of the Jamilo LMS project. If I pick Jamilo LMS here, okay? If I pick Jamilo Association, I will get to the homepage of the Jamilo Association. If I pick Jamilo LMS, I will get back to Jamilo LMS. So this is basically the generic interface. Now we're gonna delve a little bit deeper inside the interface of a specific project. But before that, I just wanted to check, maybe you know, maybe you don't, but every search box in Firefox can be linked to a specific key. So let's see, for example, I have the support.jamilo.org. So let's say I want to easily search for a task. Let's say I want to look for task 4545. Okay, that's a number of issue, an ID of an issue. Okay, there we go. I'm getting to the issue 4545. Okay, let's say that I'm on another website. So I'm on Google. Okay, I'm google.com. I'm here. I went to wherever. I went in Maps, and I want to jump from here directly to the task 4545. Now the only way to do that normally would be to get to Redmine and then connect, and then once we're there, we're inside the right project, look for 4545 here. But what you can do in Firefox is click right here and say add a keyword. That's in French here for me, but add a keyword for this search. And that will pop up a new window in which you can select. You can say, yeah, that's a search term for support.jamilo.org. And then say that you want to put export jamie.org SEO. Okay, that's it, and you register it. Now, if you're on another website and you suddenly want to see 4545, you just type SEO, which is your search keyword, 4545, and it will directly jump you to the tag. So I really recommend that you store the search keyword inside your browser, because it's really making things much faster in terms of looking for specific tasks. So if you want to become a Jamila developer, then you definitely want to know about this project, and the first thing that we will ask you to do is to learn how to report bugs and learn how what the coding conventions are for Jamila. So that typically is placed in the wiki. Okay, that's in the information database, and in the wiki you will find how to report bugs, and you will also find here coding conventions. Okay, we're gonna get back to the wiki afterwards, but that should be your first steps inside as a future developer of Jamila LMS. So here on the homepage you will see a small introduction of the project, the sub projects if there are any, and then a list of all the issues inside the system by category, okay, by type of issue. It's more correct to say the type of issue. So you have bug, feature, support, to do, usability, this kind of stuff. And you can see that for this project, at least, we only have bugs, feature, and support. Support is generally someone asking for help or for an answer regarding something that he doesn't understand. Features are new features asked by users, and bugs are issues that talk about something that doesn't work. We can see all the issues. We can see a calendar. The calendar is a specific view that allows you to really locate bug fixes or bug reports in time. So you can see here every day is marked with a small array. That's a small arrow. That's the green arrow indicates when a specific bug has been reported. You can see that all the bug reports are growing in number here, just growing, increasing in number. And when it's marked red, that means that it's supposed to be closed. As you can see, the due date is on the 15th of July. Okay, so that's how we try to arrange stuff, so it's easier for us to organize the dates at which every kind of element should be closed. Okay, very good. So that was the calendar. We also have a Gantt chart. If you have configured correctly all the tasks, then it will really appear nicely. Otherwise, it will appear something like that. So we don't really have dependencies. We really have precedences, because basically if somebody wants to take over a task, then it just takes it over. That's how we work in this project. Obviously we have people working on it and who have assignments, specific assignments, but they are free to choose at what time they do this one or this one. They just have to go forward with all of them at some point. Okay, so let's go back to the overview of the project. On the right side you have the members box, which gives you a list of all the members by role. So you have managers, developers, reporters. Reporters are usually people who report new problems they found in the software, but they're not developers, so they don't fix them, but they report it. It's really important to have people, independent people from the developers who report bugs, because sometimes developers, even if they do a great job, they can't really be in the skin of all the users. So reporters are really important. They represent our users. And then you have the latest news for this project. So the next tab is the activity tab. The activity tab is a tab that shows how active was the project today or yesterday, or it goes back in time. But as you can see, every day has something occurring. So if you look at it, it's pretty much, if you just added a, so let's say you added a task, okay? So here I added a task a few minutes ago before starting this tutorial, and you can see that adding a task is like a yellow sticker, no, like a post-it. And then if I added a comment, if anybody added a comment to a task, you can see a small chat bubble. And then if someone closed or rejected the task, then it's marked checked. No? That one's been checked already. And then if you have a task addition, then it's a small pencil. And then if you have a version control commit, a new version, then you have a small mechanical wheel. Okay, so what can you see here? You can see the time at which something was modified, the ID of the issue, the status, if it has been changed, and the title of the issue. This all is a link to the issue itself. So if we click on the link, we can see the details of the issue. At the same time, you also have the first line of the comment or the description of the issue, and the name of the person that made this change to the issue. You have a series of filters on the right side which allow you to put some more information inside that activity presentation. The roadmap tab is pretty much made to allow you to organize the development in versions. So it is based on versions that you will define in the settings tab as a project administrator, but otherwise it will not, I mean, you won't have anything showing here unless it is included inside a planned version, a scheduled version. So here you can see that 19RC1, the release candidate one, is scheduled in 11 days, and we still have 139 tasks open. So we should close 10 per day or something like that to get to the objective. You can see a green bar, a double green bar actually, a dark green bar and a light green bar. The dark green bar indicates how many tasks in considering the total amount of tasks, so in this case 210, you can see that already like 30% of all these tasks have been closed, and actually you can see it here, 34%. And then you have the 66% open, but from the 66% we already are more or less at halfway, because the progress for each of these tasks has been changed and has been marked as a, you know, as almost resolved. We're gonna see how the stages work regarding that. But if you want to know about the version, so you can click on 129 open, and you will get to the list of all features that are still pending before you can release the version RC1. That's the idea of the versions. And then you have the other versions due in 18 days, so 7 days later. Then you have version 192, sorry, etc., etc. By default, we only show the feature requests inside the short list here, but you can also add the bugs, and then it becomes a bit more messy, okay, because there are usually much more bugs than feature requests. Every new feature created generally triggers something weird in one case and another. And that's pretty much it for the roadmap. So if we go to issues now, we're gonna see a list of issues. So it's the same, these are the same issues that we would have seen in the roadmap view, but in more details, and it's not sorted by version. It's basically all the issues are present here. You can see the ID of the issue, which is very important, because from any place, this, where you can edit text around in Redmine. You can indicate a hash sign, the number of the task, and it will link automatically to this task. The tracker is the type of task, so bug, feature, or support. The status is generally new when it's started, assigned when it's assigned to someone, and then testing or need feedback when it is assumed to be finished, but that we require someone to counter check it. So the idea here is that in Chamilo LMS, a developer cannot close his own task. Someone has to come by and check that effectively the fix or the feature developed by the developer is working. Okay, otherwise he has to comment and say why he considers that that is not working. But that ensures that the developers won't get cocky and say, you know, yeah, that's okay, I'm very good at it, so I can close it automatically. No, they have to check with someone else. Okay, that increases the quality of the project. So here on the first part you have, I was talking about the status. When it's closed, then it disappears from this list, and that's because we have a filter here that says status open. Okay, then you have the subject of the issue, which should always try to fit in something around 100 characters, because otherwise it starts being very difficult to read this list. Then you have the author of the issue, and which is the person who started the issue. And then you have the target version, which is what allows us to know how many tasks have to be finished before our RC1 in the roadmap view. And then we have a percentage done. That means a percentage complete of the percentage of completeness of the task. So if you want to, you can also add filters. You know, you can say, oh, I want the priority to be high. I want to see only the issues of which the priority is high. I want to see how only the tasks that are complete at more than 50%, and then I would put a person done here, that kind of stuff. Okay, you have pagination, so you can decide whether to show 25 or 100 or 250 in only one page. You can see here that we have 25 per page, and we have 6 pages only for version RC1. Okay, so to declare a new issue, you would go to new issues here, to the new issues tab, and here you can pick which type of issue it is, if it's a bug, if it's a feature, or if it's a support. Then you can add a subject, which is a demo issue. For example, in this case, something's wrong. Yeah, something is wrong, demo issue. Okay, demo issue 2, because I already created one. And then we add the comment here saying how we get the issue and how to reproduce it. And then we leave the rest pretty much open, usually when we are not a developer. Now, if you're a developer and you know, or you can actually assign it to someone, then you should assign it directly to someone like this, assigned, and then assigned to, pick a developer in the list. Okay, but otherwise, I mean, if you don't know, you just leave it open. The target version will also be set by us. So if it's a bug, don't worry, we will consider it in the closest version to be released. Then you have complexity, which you can define by yourself in the platform administration settings. And then you have a start date, a due date, an estimated time, which allows us to schedule this task, because for example we know that someone will not have 3 hours straight to work on this, so we start to push it a little bit later if it takes 3 hours to close. And then the percentage done is the amount of completeness that is correct to describe this task. And then you can attach files, you can add other files here if you want. And finally, receive every change in status, every new comment by email to this task. I mean, so if I select Julio Montoya, then he will receive the announcement of this task, this issue being created. But at the same time, every time someone adds a comment, it will also send him an email. So don't abuse this option. There we go. So that's a task that we created. We can find again all the fields that we had seen before in the creation form. Okay. And then you have the description, and then we have the possibility to add subtasks. That means that if I click there, I will be sent to another form to register a new issue. But I can define a sub issue if I think that this issue here is a bit too much to be done in one go. So I prefer dividing it into several pieces. And then we have the related issues, and the related issues is very practical as well. And it also plays in the Gantt chart. If you really put, for example, if you say that it follows another task, then in the Gantt chart, it will appear as to be started after the first one has been finished. And as you can see, if you're feeling comfortable with Gantt, you also know that you can set delays in days between the end of the first issue and the start of the second one. Okay, so we have several options. If I want to add comments to this task, I will click update, and I will add my comments. Great, I will put great. Okay, so if I know that that this changes the statutes or something like that, I will select and put the changes here and say, okay, it's a sign, that's okay, it's part of RC1, okay, well, I'm gonna leave it empty. It's assigned to, yeah, that's okay, says opera, is good. And then I'm gonna say, if I've spent some time here, I will just log the time and say, okay, that's been support time until now. Yeah, so here with in the comments, I put talking with the client, okay, for example. No, so I know that I've been talking with the client for 2 hours, so I pointed it here, and then it will be visible in the list of the connections and registers of time used to resolve that issue. You can attach files, you can link, and here the help, formatting help, is a small window, but it's also, I mean, at the end of the window, you also have more information still, but that basically tells you how to format your comments without the need of HTML, for example. That's very interesting as well. So once we're happy, we can just click on submit, and submit will register the task, and that's it. Okay, so now I know that I'm gonna delete these, but I mean that's gonna be in a few minutes still. So we've seen us up to new issue, to create an issue. News is simply announcements that can be sent by email to all the participants of the project. Documents is the documents area, so you can upload specific documents in specific sections. You have the wiki, which is the way for us to coordinate all the information that we have about the development of the project, like the coding conventions, how to report bugs, and that kind of stuff. The files tab is a list of all the files stored in this project. The repository is very, very important. It's a copy, or it's a somehow a mashup Git or Mercurial or Bazaar or Subversion or even CVS, you might want to use to connect these version control systems to Redmine. And that's done through the settings tab. And inside the settings tab, you have a lot of settings as well. So you can just check repository, and here you can put a URL of where the sources of the project that you're dealing with are stored on the same server as Redmine. It has to be there. Well, apart from that, so the repository allows you as well to make a difference between two versions. So for example, here I want to know what happened in the last day or so. So I click view differences, and then I can see instantly the things that have changed inside the code of Jamila. Okay. There we go. So we've seen everything except the details of the issues. When I create a new issue, there's no big deal. I have to fill the form. Let's see. There we go. So in issues. Okay. In issues, if I want to show that in the code I've been doing some hacking and I've been having a lot of success doing so, inside every one of the issues that have been changed through a version control system has a little additional block here, associated revisions, it says. Okay, that is a direct link to the revision that fixes, that supposedly fixes that problem. So what you can see here is that we use a specific denomination for that. This is a keyword to recognize that the comment, this is a comment added to Mercurial, and it has nothing to do with the markup in Redmine directly. So what we did is configure in Redmine that if it checks C, if it sees the word C and then followed by a hash key, then and followed by a number, then it could consider this commit and this entire commit to be part of the task 5141. And if we look at it, it's actually what it does. So basically putting this one here, this C task, means that in the task itself, it will, after a while, after synchronizing, it will recover the details of this commit and leave it there. And that's very, very important to do the tracking of the changes that actually fixed a specific problem, because sometimes we have regression, we have problems that have happened before. So it's very useful to have a to have an example at hand of what we did to fix it previously. Okay, so I can add, if I want to add comments, I can add comments. Let's go to our test issues. Problems. Okay, no, that's. I'm changing the filter here. Okay, so that's demo issue 2. Okay, we had set it to 2 hours. We put that we had done some work, 50%. And then now I want to say, okay, it seems to be completed. So I checked it. So Cesar was the one to update it, supposedly. So I checked it and I say, okay, for me, for example. Okay, thank you all. And then you can change the status and say, okay, this one is resolved. Okay, because it's a bug. Because it's a bug, and you can see that here in the tab of the browser, because if it's a bug, it's resolved. If it was a simple feature request, it would be closed. No, it would be implemented. But resolve implies something like give a solution to something. And yeah, anyway. The need feedback option is when a developer assumes it's over, but requires the attention of another person to confirm that he's right. Okay. Here in this case, because it was a demo issue, I'm gonna put closed or rejected, better even. Okay. So because it's rejected, that means that nobody else will be able to write in the course until it's unblocked in some way. In the course, nobody else will be able to add comments to this task unless there are developers and they have the right to reopen the task. Okay, very good. So I click on submit, and then this change of task properties will be registered here. So here I say that I see, that the task moved from assigned to rejected. Okay. And so the task will not appear anymore because it's considered closed by a rejection. Okay, it doesn't appear anymore. But I mean, what I wanted to show is that you can update any task and then write whatever you want. But you have to have the correct permissions to do that. Okay, so I'm adding undead. Write whatever you want. And then I want to close it. Okay, I have a few people answering it. So the progress went up. Okay, and then it requires testing or it needs feedback. Okay, so I'm assigning it to me, but I'm saying okay, it should have feedback. All right. Then everybody looking at this task afterwards know that they can be of assistance here and just say, okay, usually when I'm gonna check a task, I'm gonna say, okay, checking now. And then if I'm not the person assigned to it, I will change the assignment and set it to me. Okay, I will say, yeah, okay, I'm okay, I will check that it's working, and then if that works out, right? So by doing this, by assigning it to you and say okay, checking now, you make it so that it's less likely for somebody else to do the same at the same time. Okay, they will probably be looking at the same issue, and so they will receive a message saying that something is being done with this issue. Okay, so here I'm happy with it, so I will close it. We rejected actually, but that's pretty much the same as far as we are concerned here. There we go. And if we go back to the issues, you can see we don't have any demo issue anymore. Okay. So, very good example here. We have Marco who added some task in while we were speaking. Okay. All right. So inside the issues, inside the issue screen, you have filters and you have options, but you can also save a filter. So let's say I only want to see the ones who have been authored by me. Okay, I'm okay with that. Okay, there you go. So it says I have reported 92. Okay, very good. So I want to filter it to narrow. Camille, this one I also want, another option. So for example, everything for beta or for RC1. Okay, apply, and I see a list of only 27. And then I'm very happy with this search, so what I will do is save it here and give it a name. So Yannick decided it should be public in the sense that every user getting to the Jamuloa installation should be able to reuse that search query. For projects, no, we're not gonna do so much. And then we can define the default columns that should appear in the result, in the listing. And you have a lot of other options here, or the same options that we've seen before, but you can select, still alter a little bit, and then you can sort by column and by type of sorting. So I'm just gonna save it. There we go. Okay. So basically now we have Yannick for C1 on the right side, okay, because it's a saved search. So if I click on it, I will get only the results of this search, and I'm not happy with it, so I can delete it. Okay. There we go. So the Yannick element didn't appear here. Okay. I think that we're pretty much almost done. We still have to see the time tracking features. So time tracking feature is quite nice. It's actually, it's a plugin. So if you are an administrator, you have to go to administration, check on plugins, and then you have here, you have to add the plugin in a specific directory inside your Redmine installation for it to be understood by Redmine. And then you can see the Redmine time tracker plugin. You just configure it and that's it. All right. So once you've done that, the every issue, I recommend that you go to the issue and register time. So as soon as you start working on an issue, just click on start here on the top right side, because basically that will start your timer for this task. Now if you clicked on it, it's counted on the server as well, so you don't have to worry about disconnecting your browser or restarting your computer. You just leave it running, and when you're done with the task in whichever other page that it will be, you will see that header, and you just click on stop, and then that sends you to a specific page where you have to appoint the amount of time that you spent on the project, which is by default it should be the correct time, all right? Unless you started before you started, you started to work on it before you started the timer, then you can adjust it here. Let's say that by default it was suggesting that it was 0.31 hour, sorry. So it would be like 20 minutes or something. And you put a comment, you say counted time for nothing. Yeah, so I'm gonna reduce it because I don't want to really modify the current timing tracking. And then you select the activity. So for example here it would be development, if it's a graphical design or usability design, it should go to design. And if it's supports or people getting requiring assistance, then you would have to mark it as support, and then that will allow you later on, if you go back to overview of the project, on the right side you can see details. Yeah, if you click on details, you're gonna see all the people who registered some time working on Jamuloa, okay, Jamuloa LMS. So they registered some time, and then you can generate a report. So you can say, for example, I want a monthly report with the member and the tracker. So now we're gonna see for every person how long they spent on bugs, how long they spent on features, and how long they spent on support. So we get to the end of the list, we're gonna see the amount of hours there. Okay. You can also define a time frame and that kind of things. if you want to, there are a part from the repository that you can define here. I don't know if you remember that. You can define it in the settings, in the project settings. Here you can define the repository. But in the repository, you can also make a difference between versions of the code. So for example, let's say that index should have changed recently. Okay, so on the 25th of June, that was the latest commit by Laurent Brecht. And then we select another date and say, okay, I want to see what happened here in a month or so. Because you see the 29th of May and 25th of June. So you want to see the differences between those two. And you just click the View Differences button. You can see all the differences. Red is that a line has been removed. Green is that a line has been added. Okay, great. There are a number of options, of additional options that you can access to by through the administration page, which enable you to connect your Redmine to other applications. So you have a private key. You can send emails to get new tasks registered. And that's pretty much it. Okay, so if you have any question, don't hesitate to tweet me. That's YWarnier, so that's this account.